Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome, everyone. Would you please pray with us?
Lord, we come before you today. We thank you for this day you have given us. We come to exalt and lift up your holy name. May you be praised this morning and just be with us here in our worship. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. Let's stand together and praise the Lord. Take a moment, greet your neighbor this morning.
Hello, neighbor.
Neighbor. I didn't hit that last one. I'm going to take it once or take it twice or take it. So I just. I saw the light. We're doing I Saw the Light next, right?
Yeah.
Off my way. Off my way?
Yeah.
Okay.
Would you make your way back to your seats? Continue standing and praising with us. it shine till Jesus comes. I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine till Jesus comes. I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine till Jesus comes. I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine. Let it shine. Let it shine. I'll fly away, oh glory. I'll fly away in the morning. When I die, hallelujah, my heart. I'll fly away.
I am weak, but thou art strong. Jesus, keep me from all wrong. I'll be satisfied as long as I walk. Let me walk. Oh, just a closer walk with thee. Brandon, Jesus is my plea. Daily walking close to thee. Let it be, dear Lord, let it be.
Good morning. Isn't that a great way to start the day? My goodness, such great singing and praising. It's awesome. Happy Thanksgiving to all of you. As I started to think about my communion meditation, I started recalling all of the things that I'm thankful for. And one of the very first things that I thought of was Smithville Christian Church. Oh, how blessed we are. All of you, being our friends, being our family, being the people that go out and do the work in our community. You out do outreach beyond measure, and how grateful I am for all of you. A few weeks ago, we were blessed to be a part of the Trunk or Treat here at our church. And as many of you know, you worked hard getting ready for that event, and our great ministers most certainly did. But it was a dreary day, and so all the festivities had to be moved inside. And we came in downstairs in the basement. There was game set up in every corner. Teresa Nethery was making the best cotton candy around, and you should have seen the smiles on the faces of the little children when they came up and asked if they could have some and how much it cost. And Teresa would say, "It's free, take two." We had the cakewalk, which is always my childhood favorite. I was always so proud when I was little. We went to the local fire station and had a cakewalk, and I was so proud to come home with a cake to share with the family. Very, very special memories for me. You came upstairs, you saw more smiles, you saw more fun, you saw more fellowship. We had all the chairs removed, and there was tables set up, and our good church people had set up booths for the children to come table to table. Aurora was sitting at one table with a special message, and she told me a few days later a story that I will cherish forever. She said, Caroline, who's my little granddaughter, she's 4 years old, and her friends came up, and Aurora was taking just a minute or two to teach them about God. And suddenly, Caroline said, Miss Aurora, we're not here to learn about God. We're here for the candy. And she is absolutely right. The children were here for the candy. And we were here to teach them about Jesus. I'm thankful for the teachers that I had when I was a little girl. I'm thankful for the teachers that my children had. Mark Breedlove is one of the great. And he had my children. He was a teacher for years and years and years. He just moved along with my kids, I think. And I always appreciate that. I think he signed up for a year or two and was there for 20. But anyway, what I want us to remember today as we take communion is to keep teaching, keep sharing the best message ever, that Jesus Christ gave his life on the cross so you and I could have everlasting life. That's really the best message to share. That's really what we should be thankful for. Let us pray. Dear Jesus, I'm so grateful for our church family, thankful for each and every one of them who bring light to men and women, boys and girls. I cherish the memories. I look forward to the future. And we know that Jesus is our Savior. He's alive and well. He's there. We're remembering today as we take communion that he gave his life for you and for me. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Thank you.
God, we thank you that you love us, Lord, for the joy that you put inside of our hearts. And Lord, we come now with that spirit of joy to give our tithes and offering to you to honor and worship your name. Be exalted. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
I've heard about this baby boy who's come to earth to bring us joy, and I just wanna sing this song to you. It goes like this: the fourth, the fifth, the minor fall, the major lift. With every breath I'm singing hallelujah, 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 hallelujah.
A couple came to Bethlehem expecting child. They searched the inn to find a place, for you were coming soon. There was no room for them to stay, so in a manger filled with hay, God's only son was born.
The shepherds left their flocks by night to see this baby wrapped in light. A host of angels led them all to you. It was just as the angel said, you'll find him in a manger bed. Emmanuel and Savior, hallelujah. in the east to Bethlehem. The wise men three came many miles and journeyed long for you. And to the place at which you were, the frankincense and gold and myrrh.
Sixth grade and below, you can go to Children's Church. The rest of us will turn in our Bibles to Acts chapter 3. Acts chapter 3. If you don't have a Bible, there's one under the chair probably in front of you, and take that. And if you don't have a Bible of your own, just take that one home with you. It would be our gift to you. We'd love for you to have it. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for this wonderful morning to be with the family, our brothers and sisters who are called under your Son's name. Father, we come to this special, special week, a special week of where we focus on your will for us, which is to be grateful in our Savior, Christ Jesus. And Father, to live in this will sometimes, we begin to struggle because we live in this fallen world, surrounded by fallen people, and then sometimes we fall ourselves. And Father, we need your forgiveness daily. We need your grace, and we need your leading, and especially this morning, we need your Spirit to do the work, to speak to us through your word. May you just use any words shared for me as your tool to sharpen each one of us, myself included. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, as I said in the prayer, this week is very special. There's a very special day. That day is Thanksgiving. For some of you, though, that special day is Black Friday, isn't it? And Black Friday is special to you because that's when you can get that good deal. And so you're going to get up early on Friday or maybe even go to bed late on Thursday because you are going to hunt for that good deal. You've been scoping it out. You've been planning it out. And for you to get the good deal, you're going to have to be at the right place at the right time. Now, when we realize we're in the right place at the right time, we begin to be filled with a sense of gratitude like no other time. And we're grateful because we know that there's no better place to be at that specific time. When have you been in the right place at the right time? When you met your spouse? Amen. How about when you got the job? Or maybe she said yes to go to the dance? Or when you launched your business? Was it because you were at the right place at the right time? This gratitude feeling that accompanies being in the right place at the right time is one that says, my goodness, I'm favored. I'm special. And this is amazing. Well, in Acts chapter 3, I believe we find a guy who's at the right place at the right time. Beginning in verse 1, now Peter and John were going up to the temple at the ninth hour, the hour of prayer. And a man who had been lame from his mother's womb was being carried along, whom they used to sat down every day at the gate of the temple, which is also called Beautiful, in order to beg for alms of those who were entering the temple. This guy would go to the temple to beg for money. That's what the alms was about. It was about money. Now, a lot of things seem not to have gone right for this guy who is begging at the temple. More than 2,000 years ago, to be born with any type of physical limitation was a bigger hindrance than it is today. I don't mean to minimize the hindrance it is today, but it was even a bigger hindrance. There was no ability for a man, if he couldn't walk, to earn a living other than by begging. And so this man, knowing that his life was limited to begging, he was strategically placed at the gate Beautiful. It was a luxurious gate at the temple. The temple gates were made of bronze at this time, but the gate Beautiful was even adorned with silver and gold. And so it was strategic that this gentleman was placed there at this gate so those who walked through the gate would look at all the lavish luxury of this gate and be reminded of how much they have. And out of their prosperity, with compassion, they would give to this man who had a need. And certainly when people gave him money, and they must have because he returned to that place daily. And if he wasn't getting money there, he wouldn't return back to where he wasn't getting money. But surely when people gave him money, he would begin to think sometimes, I'm at the right place. Surely I'm at the right place. This man is in his right place, his usual place. Verse 3. When he saw Peter and John about to go into the temple, he began asking to receive alms. He asked them for money. He says, hey, I need some money. I'm at the right place. You're going through this gate. This points out all the wealth that's around me. I need some money. Can you spare some money? And when you take the 3rd Street exit going north on 37. There is one gentleman, there's two gentlemen that will rotate that stop. And it's a strategic location, if you think about it. If you're taking the 3rd Street exit, you're going there to either probably eat out or go shopping. So if you're going to eat out, you probably have some cash on you to at least leave a tip with cash, even if you pay with the card. And if you didn't know, waiters and waitresses appreciate that if you leave it in cash. We won't go into all that, but that's between them and IRS. But you have some cash on you. Perhaps you're going shopping. Perhaps you're swinging by Starbucks over there. Perhaps you're going to Lowe's. It's a great place. It's a strategic place to ask for money. And so there will be a gentleman there with a sign asking for money. And when you feel compassion and you give money, he must certainly say, I'm at the right place. He must be. That's why he returns to that place daily. Now, sometimes we find ourselves in the wrong place. We're traveling along. We need to put fuel in the car, and so we take an exit. And we're unfamiliar with the exit, but when we take the exit, we realize it's very congested. We're like, oh my goodness, how long is this stop going to take? And you get to the gas station, there's a line at the fuel pumps. And then one of the kids says, I need to go to the restroom. And so one of you takes the children to the restroom, the other one's in the line to get gas for the car. And when you take the children to the restroom, you open the door of your restroom, you go, oh my. Oh my. Don't touch anything, kids. In fact, don't sit down. And it's scary. You're like, oh my goodness, this place is scary. And so you survive the experience and you get back in the car and you look at your spouse and you say, we got to get out of here. We're in the wrong place. We camped off Big Mac Lake in Nebraska over the summer. Isn't that a beautiful lake? For some reason, there wasn't a bunch of people right there on the lake. And I thought, wow, this is beautiful. This is like an oasis. Why wouldn't there be a bunch of people here? Well, it ends up there was a storm forecasted for that night, and I didn't take in consideration what a storm might do on a lake like Big Mac, because Big Mac Lake is 20 miles in length, 4 miles across. The dam in the background there is 3 miles across, and there we are, like idiots, ready to take on the brunt of that storm sideways. If you've ever been in a high wind storm, broadside in a camper, it tosses you a lot. Aurora woke me up. She says, oh my goodness, what's going on? She goes, did you unhook the truck? And I said, of course I unhooked the truck. She goes, oh my goodness. And we looked out the window. Anybody else that was there was leaving. I was like, well, where are we going to go? We're over 1,000 miles from home. We didn't know where we would go, but we definitely knew we were in the wrong place. It never feels good to be in the wrong place. Maybe you went to the wrong place with a friend. We all have. You took a wrong turn or made a poor choice. Being in the wrong place stinks, doesn't it? But to be in the right place, I mean, to get that great deal on Black Friday, to be in the stand when the trophy buck walks by, to be there at the game when the big play is made, and oh yes, that was IU over Kentucky, buzzer beater. Three-pointer, we all remember that game. Sometimes I pull it up on YouTube. They have the Hoosiers song going in the background. It's one thing when IU wins. It's another when they beat Kentucky. And all of God's people said, amen. Amen. Yeah, it's great to be in the right place, especially when a baby is born. You've been there? Isn't that miraculous? Isn't that amazing? It'll come to you in life where you get to be there and celebrate that moment, or celebrating a believer coming to Christ and being buried into the waters of baptism to rise a new life. And it's great. And you have this spirit of gratitude that fills you. And you say, oh my goodness, there's no place I'd rather be. The Mayflower set sail from Holland September 6, 1620, the ship's 102 passengers were determined to establish a settlement in the New World that would honor God. In the book Making Haste from Babylon, Nick Bunter captures the essence of the pilgrim's worldview. This is what he writes. The pilgrims believed that everything followed a plan laid down by God before the beginning of the world. Now, the pilgrims intended, if you remember in history, to land on a small island, I don't know if you ever heard of it, called Manhattan. They missed that island by 250 miles to the north. They drifted off course, landed on Cape Cod. When they arrived at Cape Cod, they had no friends to welcome them, no inns to entertain them, no settlement to protect them, just barren country full of woods and thickets. It was weather wild country. And when they realized they were 250 miles from their destined point, they thought, well, maybe we should sail south. But howling headwinds and treacherous tides persuaded the ship's captain, Christopher Jones, that they shouldn't even attempt it. And the pilgrims perceived this was God's providence, that this was God's plan for be it this right place there at Cape Cod. That God wanted them to stay in this desolate place. That God had brought them to the right place. William Bradford went on to serve as governor of the new colony, and he recalled in his journal the moment of them being in the right place with gratitude, saying these words. Being thus arrived in good harbor and brought safe to land, they fell upon their knees and blessed the God of heaven who had brought them over the vast and furious ocean. The pilgrims, as they got off the boat there, were surprised as they wandered along in the thickets to discover an area of ground that was cleared of trees. What they also discovered there is that someone had planted corn there and abandoned it. There was a Native American tribe that had planted corn there in that region, several acres. They'd suffered a plague, and so they left the area. And it just so happened, at just the right time, when the corn was in harvest, that's when the pilgrims came to that particular spot, 250 miles away from their destined destination. But was that really their destined destination? Or was God bringing them to a place where they would have food? I don't know how many fields of corn were abandoned there along the east coast for them to just so happen to find, as some would say. But they also found a great water supply. Bradford described as a very sweet brook and many delicate springs, as good of water as can be drunk. One of those pilgrims, Edward Winslow, wrote these words. He said, "It was God's good providence that we found the corn and the water." The pilgrims were grateful to be not only at the right place, but also at the right time. The crippled man in Acts chapter 3 would soon find that he also would be at the right place at the right time. Reading verse 4, that Peter and John, they walked by and they looked at him. They didn't just look forward over their steering wheels, acting like they didn't see him. No, they looked at him. When they looked at him and he asked for money, him expecting some money, Peter said this, "I do not have any silver or gold for you, but I'll give you what I do have. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, get up and walk." Now, the writer of Acts, his name was Luke, and by profession he was a physician. And if we remember, he noted that this man was lame from his mother's womb. He was born crippled. He was born not able to walk. He'd never experienced that before. It wasn't an accident that happened, but this is the way he was his whole life. But then he has this encounter, and it's like no other. I wonder, though, at first, if he was disappointed that Peter didn't give him any money. And perhaps even skeptical that Peter said, "Get up and walk." Well, then Peter took the lame man by his hand and he helped him up. And as he did, the man's feet and the ankles strengthened for the very first time in his life. Imagine, as a little boy, maybe his mother and father held him up and trying to teach him to walk, but every time it was a fail. And now he is a man. He has strength in his legs and in his ankles, and you know what he starts doing? He starts walking, and I don't think it was like this. This guy was moving. He was leaping, Scripture says. He was praising God, and he goes into the temple with Peter and John. He had seen others walk daily. He saw them walk right by him. He had other people carry him right where he needed to go. He never could do it on his own, and now all of a sudden he's able to leap and leap with joy and praise God and walk where he wanted to go. Have you ever noticed that we take for granted the strength we have daily to do the necessary things daily? Have you thanked God today for the ability to do what you can do? All of us have different abilities, and some of us have limited abilities, but if we thank God, are we grateful to God like this man is? He comes into the temple with a grand entrance, leaping with joy, grateful to God, praising God to be at the right place at the right time. I'm sure some of them were like, "Oh my goodness, this guy over here is jumping. Next thing you know, he's going to be clapping. Oh my goodness, I'm going to sit by the clapper over here." Why? He was praising God, just like you were praising God and led to clap this morning during the songs and praise God, because you know you're in the right place at the right time. Now, I don't know everything going on in your life, and thank goodness you don't know everything going on in mine. But I praise God that we're at the right place at the right time right now. You're hearing the Word of God. You're lifting up the Son of God. You're where you're supposed to be. Don't question that. This is the way to start off your week, with the family of God. And when you're with the family of God as a priority in the beginning of the week, you're going to experience the blessing of God. Does that mean everything's going to go as you want it to go? No, it is not. You're having your family over this week. It's not going to go how you want it to go. It doesn't work that way. I mean, if you remember in Acts chapter 3, the man wanted money. He didn't get money. Peter said, "Silver and gold I do not have." Yet by the powerful name of Jesus, he experienced what money could not offer him. He experienced a transformation, and he experienced great gratitude, and so he's praising God. You know, there's times when I ask for something that's in God's will, and there's times that I ask for things that are not a part of God's will, but I know that God's will is greater than what I want. Do you trust that in your life? That God's will, God's plans, even if they take you off course like it did for the pilgrims from what you had in mind, God's will is greater than our will. Now, how do you know God's will? Like, oh, here we go. Talking about the will of God, the great, great mystery of the will of God. I don't believe it's a mystery, though. Because the Bible says that we are to pray continually, be joyful always, and give thanks in all circumstances. This is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. How do we live in God's will? Well, we give our lives, our bodies to God because of all he's done for you. And let them be a living and holy sacrifice unto him, the kind he will find acceptable. This is truly the way you worship God. Don't copy the behaviors and the customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. Then you will know, and then you will see what God's will is for you, his good and pleasing and perfect will. When the people in the temple saw the man from the beautiful gate walking, leaping, and praising God, they were astonished, they were amazed about the transformation that happened to this man through Jesus Christ, through the name of Jesus Christ. And when I see people transformed by Jesus Christ today, I am amazed. When I look at my own self of where I've been just a few years ago, I'm absolutely amazed about what God has done, even though that I am completely helpless. It is recorded in them several hundred years ago, around the year 1140, Pope Innocent II was the pope at that time, and he was very proud of the Vatican at that day because there was so much luxury within it. A theologian, Thomas Aquinas, came to visit the Pope, and the Pope was proud to show him around at all the luxury of the temple and all that he had to adorn it. And he said, "We no longer say, 'Silver and gold have I none.'" That's what the Pope told Thomas. To which Thomas replied, "Perhaps that is why we no longer say, 'Get up and walk.'" See, when we begin to trust in what we can do for ourselves, when we begin to trust in what we can earn rather than what God can do through his power, we lose the real power. And to see the transforming power of Jesus Christ is amazing, it's astonishing, it's phenomenal. To have our fallen state buried into the waters of baptism, to rise and live a new life for the glory of God in Jesus Christ, and to have an identity of Jesus Christ, that is absolutely amazing grace. I can't imagine anything else that's comparable. And it's only possible because we came like the lame man when we were utterly helpless, and Christ came at just the right time and died for us sinners. And what did he make us? The Bible says he made us saints. If you read the New Testament, you find a special name for those who belong to Jesus Christ and are called his church, and it's a humbling name, and that name is saint. And 43 times in the New Testament, you read to the saints, referring to the church, to the saints in Ephesus, and Christ be with you. And it's humbling. Because we've died and we've been buried with Christ in baptism. And just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glorious power of the Father, now we are also raised to live new lives, triumphant lives, victorious lives. Because my old self has been crucified with Christ and I no longer live, but Christ, Jesus Christ, who died on the cross for my sins and rose from the grave, the resurrected Christ lives in me and he's changing me. Just as he changed the pilgrims, as Christ changed the pilgrims who came to this land 400 years ago, them living their new life didn't fare so well for them where they came from. They experienced persecution from King James and also by even the citizens of Holland where they fled to first. And so they came here so they could live the new life, to be free in Jesus Christ, not to be under the oppression of a tyrant government. As they came over and as they came to that new land, there on the ship, they noted down our government's very first piece of document governing authority. It's called the Mayflower Compact. And in the Mayflower Compact, you will read the purpose of the pilgrims coming to this land. Let me read just one line from it. Having undertaken for the glory of God and the advancement of the Christian faith, they came here to live a new life. They came here to share the good news of Jesus Christ. Did you read about the Mayflower Compact in history class? Probably not. It's not so convenient for many who control those things in society today. But if we study our history, we find this rich Christian heritage of people who lived the new life and trusted in God. The very first winter was so tough on the pilgrims. They must have thought, like we often think, am I really in the right place? I mean, that first winter killed half of them. Half of them didn't make it. As spring came on, surely they thought, we've got to find a new place to be. This place is not going to work. Early in the spring, a Native American came walking toward their settlement to welcome them. They had a fear that the natives would be savages to them, and they were scared. But this man came welcoming them. And this is how he welcomed them. He hung out too much with the fishermen along the coast, because this is how he welcomed them. He said, "Welcome, Englishmen. Do you have any beer?" That was about the only English he knew. But he had a friend, another Native American, that knew a lot of English. In fact, this man was fluent in English. His name was Squanto. Squanto had had a hard life. He had been kidnapped when he was 12 years old and taken to England as a slave, where he was for 9 years. Lived as a slave. But during those 9 years, Squanto learned English. And after he was released as being a slave, he went back to America. Probably the only fluent English-speaking Native American that was on the continent at that time. And here he finds, along that whole East Coast where they could have been, he finds the English-speaking pilgrims. And what does he do? He teaches them. He teaches them how to survive here. He teaches them how to plant corn by taking, I believe it was 5 kernels surrounded in a mound surrounded by 3 fish. And so the fish would decompose and fertilize the corn and the corn would grow. And he taught them how to fish in the stream so they could catch fish and have plenty to eat. He taught them how to live here successfully. And he's probably the only Native American on the continent that speaks English. Now, some would say that's just chance. But here he was, had met the pilgrims who also spoke English. With his bilingual skills, Squanto negotiated a peace treaty with the local tribe and the pilgrims. And because Squanto was there to intervene and use his gift of language with the pilgrims and with his people, that, my friends, is why we celebrate a day called Thanksgiving. That's how the very first Thanksgiving happened. And the pilgrims had this great gratitude that they ended up landing and they trusted God that they were in the right place at the right time. And Squanto also had a great gratitude. Squanto was quoted by Governor Bradford, and Governor Bradford noted in his journal that Squanto had made a confession of Jesus Christ and made him his Lord. I love the story Helen has told me about. I hope you don't mind me telling on it, Helen, but I think you would tell everybody that as a young lady, sometimes for obvious reasons, you would maybe get a little bit down on those who came to America and interfered in the Native Americans' lifestyle and was unfair to the Native Americans, and that's nothing to be proud of as Americans that that has happened. And you've told me that you would tell your mom sometimes about the white man came here and did this to us and did that. And your mom would say what, Helen? What would she say? If it wasn't for them coming and sharing Jesus, we wouldn't have known about Jesus. And that was more important to your mother than anything else, was to know Jesus. And it's more important to you, and it's more important to your children, because I know them, and it's more important than anything else in the world. And if we know Jesus, we can have great gratitude. And so here we are today in a great fellowship and great gratitude because everything's worked together to be in the right place at the right time, and you're a part of that as well. And maybe this morning you're here and you're going, I don't know if I'm in the right place at the right time. I want you to know that you absolutely are in the right place at the right time. If you've never accepted Jesus as your Savior, as your Lord, and been baptized into Him, you need to know this morning you're in the right place at the right time, and all the preparations are already made for you. I had this difficult question asked of me this year. I want to share it with you. Stephen, I want to know your opinion on salvation. My parents died on me at an early age. My dad when I was 16, my mom when I was 20, and I never knew if they were saved. We never went to church. We never really talked about the Lord. It wasn't until years later that I finally accepted the Lord as my Savior and grew in a relationship with Him. And this question has popped in my heart about their salvation and if I'll see my parents in heaven. I think that's the hardest question I've been asked in a long time. This is why I shared with the gentleman. If you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised Him from the dead, you'll be saved. With the heart, a person believes, resulting in righteousness, and with the mouth, he confesses, resulting in salvation. I shared with him, it's not our place to judge someone else's salvation, and it is my prayer that somebody did introduce your parents to Jesus. That's my prayer, and I pray that they trusted Him. Even if it was in their last breath of life, I just pray that they trusted in Jesus. But then I asked him, do you have any family that's still alive? Do you have a brother? Do you have a sister? Do you have an aunt? Do you have an uncle? He said, well, yeah, I do. I said, the question I have is, do they know Jesus? Do they know Jesus as Lord and Savior? He said, no. Oh, walked him through on how to share Jesus and said, I'd love to go with you and share Jesus with them. Because more than important than anything else is like what Helen said, is to know Jesus. It's to know Jesus as Lord and Savior. To know that He died on the cross for your sins, and there's no sin that you have done that He didn't already die for. But you don't know how bad my sin is. Oh, He did. And at just the right time, He died for your sin. And He justified you just as the sin never happened. He redeemed you by His precious grace, by the love of God. And you are raised to live this new life when you put your faith in Him. When you trust in Him. He is the way. He is the truth. He is the life. And no one comes to the Father except through Jesus. And I ask you this morning, have you came to Jesus? Will we see each other in heaven? We're going to stand, and as we stand, we're going to sing. And if you've not accepted Jesus as Savior, you are in the right place at the right time, and it's time you do that today. So you come as we sing, and we're going to praise God and be grateful for this wonderful time.
That saved a wretch like me.
saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found. Was blind, but now I see.
Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for your light that comes into us so that we can see, and we can see clearly. And Father, I just ask that you lead each and every person here today with gratitude in our hearts, that we know that we are in the right place at the right time, and where we're going is the right place. And we just want to keep our eyes focused on you. Lord, I just ask that their families be safe as they travel this week. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Have a happy Thanksgiving. Amen. Amen.